an island prison, home to the most infamous villains that have ever lived. Cruella de Vil, Jafar, the Evil Queen, and Maleficent. Each one has a child that has never left their side until now. Disney's Descendants, the Disney Channel movie event of the year.
Hello, Internet, and welcome to the DCOM review. Today, we'll be looking closer at Disney Channel's movie event of the year in Descendants, which has some interesting racial undertones. Sound intriguing? Don't worry, we'll get there. Kenny Ortega is finally back on the director's chair for what Disney hopes to be the High School Musical of a new generation. Speaking of which, it's been almost 10 years since High School Musical premiered. A whole decade. Crazy, right? The idea of taking all of Disney's most famous characters, giving them children, and placing them all in the same continuity is likely the most ambitious Disney Channel original movie idea since Tiger Cruise. But does the film hold up to the hype? Well, let's dive in. And a quick shout out to Melanie Ashley and Disney Meets Nickelodeon, who both suggested I review this one. The film starts with Prince Ben, son of Beast and Belle, proclaiming that the children of the Isle of the Lost be given a chance to live and learn amongst the people of Auradon. So, four kids are chosen for something of a trial run at integration. Jay, Evie, Carlos, and Mal, the children of Jafar, Cruella de Vil, Evil Queen, and Maleficent, respectively. They are initially reluctant, but their parents want to use this opportunity to break the magical barrier that Auradon has placed over the Isle of the Lost that keeps the Disney villains inside from using their magic. There's a lot of background details that are missing since this movie is based on, as well as a sequel to, the book Isle of the Lost, which I personally haven't read, so if any of you out there have, feel free to point out anything major. So the kids are shipped off to Auradon Prep, where they meet Prince Ben, along with Audrey, daughter of Sleeping Beauty, who, if you know the story, has some parental history with Mal. They also meet Doug, son of Dopey, who is, interestingly enough, not a dwarf himself, but I think that decision was for the better. But these villain kids are on a mission, to steal Fairy Godmother's magic wand and use it to free the Isle of the Lost. So, they sneak off to a museum in order to steal it and run into a wax version of their parents in addition to some other cool Disney artifacts. It's here that Mal has her first moment of internal struggle, as she starts to question whether or not evil is the path for her. This is encapsulated in the song, Like Me, where Maleficent comes to life as a figment of Mal's imagination. Once they fail to retrieve the wand, they head off to classes the next morning. It's here where the individual character arcs begin to form, as our leads begin doing their own things. Jay joins the tourney team, which is basically magical lacrosse with cannons for whatever reason. Carlos learns to befriend a dog. Evie wants to impress Chad, the son of Cinderella and Prince Charming, and Mal eventually befriends Fairy Godmother's daughter, Jane, in an attempt to manipulate her into obtaining the magic wand. I'll go deeper into the character arcs once we get to the analysis of the characters themselves. Now, this movie has one very annoying habit, and that's the way they go about introducing new characters, pretty much all of which are also descendants of someone famous. Most of the time they act so stuck up about who their parents are, they honestly believe that the greatness of their mothers and fathers should translate to everyone automatically knowing exactly who they are. That's especially true for Lonnie, since her mother is my all-time favorite Disney princess, Mulan. Why is she my favorite? All it takes is one scene. I just wish their introductions were a bit more clever. Like, how cool would it have been if Lonnie was introduced by applying makeup to half her face while looking in a mirror? Meanwhile, she's humming Reflection, the penultimate song for not looking like how you feel. It would be way more subtle, way more clever, and also function as a great parallel for what the evil kids, especially Mal, are going through. What a wasted opportunity. So anyways, after Mal gains some popularity through her magical hairbending techniques, she bakes a love potion filled cookie for Prince Ben so that he'll fall in love with her. It works, and at the end of the school's tourney game, Ben confesses his love by, of course, singing about it.
You didn't see that coming?
So Audrey dumps him on the spot and says she'll go to the coronation with Chad instead, much to the dismay of Evie. This eventually leads to Evie discovering that she is, in fact, more than just her looks when she ends up doing well on a science test and ends up spending a lot more time with Doug in the process, who genuinely believed in her and, interestingly enough, doesn't seem to hold any kind of grudge against her despite the history that their parents share from Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. So Mel and Ben go on a picnic date, which leads into what I think is the best song in the movie, If Only. Not just because I've been a Dove Cameron fan since Cloud 9, but because it paints a great emotional picture that captures the heart of Mal's struggle more so than any other point in the movie. She's gaining all of these new experiences and feeling all of these new emotions, and it rightfully causes her to question who she truly is and what she truly wants to be. It captures the central question of the movie, which is, ironically, how much does being a descendant matter? How much does your heritage and history define you versus your individual choices? Pretty tough questions to grapple with. Ben then offers to teach her what love is. So then we reach Auradon Prep's family day, where the villain kids get to video conference their parents, who remind them of their mission. They naturally find themselves at odds with the mission currently, given their positive experiences at Auradon Prep, but they plan the mission out anyways, knowing what their parents will do to them should they fail. After a modernized interpretation of the Beauty and the Beast classic Be Our Guest, we finally get a true conflict when Audrey's grandmother and the mother of Sleeping Beauty, Queen Leia, confronts Mal. She takes her bad blood with Maleficent out on Mal, with more kids joining in on confronting and ostracizing the four villain kids. This is one of the best scenes in the movie for me because it illustrates something very subtle but very powerful regarding the movie that I'll get into later. So, because nobody likes them anymore, the villain kids have a newfound commitment to their mission of stealing the magic wand. Mal decides to try and undo the love spell on Ben before his coronation, where the wand swiping will take place. But Ben has been keeping a secret.
And now, my friends, I present to you...
John Cena!
Alright, I apologize for that one. Ben is neither John Cena nor the White Ranger. The truth is, he was actually already cured after his swim in the Enchanted Lake, and he assumes that Mal did all of this out of genuine affection, which is kind of a stupid assumption.
That's stupid! You're stupid! Stop being stupid!
After the coronation happens, Mal is prepared to steal the wand, but Jane takes it first in an effort to magically obtain the beauty that she so desperately wants. This leads to Maleficent transporting down to the coronation, taking the wand, and freezing everyone in attendance. She turns into a dragon, but I couldn't find too much great footage. So instead, here's this dragon.
What are you doing here anyway? If I didn't know any better, I'd swear you were following me.
Well, maybe I am.
Well, maybe you should stop.
Maybe you should chill.
So yeah, Mal gets the best of her mother through a magical stare-off, Maleficent gets turned to a lizard for some reason, Fairy Godmother unfreezes everyone, the villain kids decide that good is good, bad isn't as good as they thought, and the coronation ends with Set It Off, a big musical dance number and a Kenny Ortega specialty for closing out movies. But with one wicked stare, Mal opens the door for who knows what in the future. Before I talk about the characters, let's harp back to one of my opening lines about the racial undertones in Descendants. If you've taken American history, then you might be familiar with the landmark civil rights case known as Brown v. Board of Education. This case deemed it unconstitutional to segregate public schools based on race, and would eventually lead into the civil rights movement of the 1960s. The events in this film are a parallel to that, because the entire plot revolves around a separate nation of villains, slowly becoming integrated into a larger, more predominant society. There is resistance to this movement, as certain members of the higher society don't want to be involved with children who they deem as lesser people simply because of who they are on the outside. See what I'm getting at? At the beginning of this movie, Ben explains that the children of the Isle of the Lost deserve the chance to be educated at Auradon Prep because he doesn't see them as any different than any other kid. He strongly and rightly believes that holding onto the past as a way to justify the present is backwards thinking. Just like in America in the aftermath of slavery, black people were still treated as lesser until a visionary came around to inform us of how wrong this all was. The swing in American racial tolerance is also paralleled here, with Ben trying to establish tolerance toward the villain kids in an effort to eventually unite people of all backgrounds. Hey, it's not called the United States of Auradon for nothing. The writers really wanted to send a message with this one, and if you really need an explanation as to why tolerance and acceptance are powerful lessons to teach, especially in the wake of far, far too many recently racially charged incidents, then...
That's stupid! You're stupid! Stop being stupid!
Now, that isn't to say that it did as good a job as it could have in terms of those aforementioned themes, but it definitely gets points for trying to be something more impactful than most DCOMs. If you're looking for something that really understands the topic and gets it right, I would direct you to The Color of Friendship. And now, the characters. As per the title of the movie, the focus is primarily on the Descendants themselves. both the ones from Ouradon and from the Isle of the Lost. The portrayals of the classic Disney characters are nothing special for the most part, but there is some funny dialogue within. Kristen Chenoweth as Maleficent is a blast, as her over-the-top acting falls in line with this movie being a musical, and the overall silly tone that the classic villains are framed in. Outside of her, the others are just okay, but it's a shame that there's no Mulan sighting in this movie. The Ouradon prep kids not named Ben are, for the most part, relatively unappreciative of having to share their school with Isle of the Lost children. Duck and Jane are okay and start off a bit more tolerant, but they are more about serving a function than being fully realized people. But Chad and Audrey are particularly annoying, as they always carry themselves as people who seem more prone to evil than the kids that are actually born from evil parents. But this move actually works, and here's why. The movie asks the question, how much does being a descendant really matter? The answer? It doesn't. Audrey and Chad are pretty deplorable people, but they're supposed to be the good guys. Their parents, at least their mothers, were some of the most kind and open-hearted people in Disney history, and yet, their kids are dicks. That's because it doesn't matter who you are, so much as what you do, because everyone, even kids of good parents, have the potential to do bad things just as kids born from evil parents have the capability to do good things. Adding yet another layer of potentially racial parallel, this movie is largely about the fact that there is good and evil in everyone, and they should be judged by the choices they make, and not the misguided perceptions of who they might be because of learned prejudices, which is what I was getting at earlier with the Queen Leia scene where she confronts Mal.
My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
Who better to hammer the point home than the great MLK himself? Alright, now that all the difficult stuff is out of the way, let's take a look at the main characters. Ben, portrayed by Mitchell Hope, is starting the revolutionary change of bringing evil children into the nation of Ouradon. For this role to work, his resolve and commitment to equality must be absolutely unbreakable and undeterrable. And he pulls off that role pretty well. Nobody is really rooting for him to succeed, not even the villains themselves are too thrilled with the idea at first, but he knows that what he's doing is the right thing to do, and stands by his first royal proclamation through both the high and the low points. And, because it bears repeating, his actions are what makes him a great character, not his parents. Jay and Carlos have pretty basic structures to their character arcs. Jay steals things and doesn't play nice with others. He joins a sports team and everything is okay. Easy enough. Carlos is afraid of dogs. He meets a dog and is no longer afraid. And that's enough to convince them both that evil is overrated. Their arcs are sensible enough based on who their parents are, but neither arc is overly deep or engaging. Boo Boo Stewart is Jay and Cameron Boyce as Carlos are fine in their roles, but they just weren't given a lot to do. Evie, portrayed by Sophia Carson, is a much better developed character. It makes sense that outward appearance would be her primary concern because Evil Queen was all about being the fairest of them all. So naturally, her daughter would grow up assuming that beauty is skin deep and being obsessed with more material things. What I like about Evie is that she proves that she's more than a little talented in several areas and eventually embraces those talents, despite her initial beliefs about beauty. This ties into her decision to eventually reject evil, because evil taught her not to place as much value on things like intelligence, which, for my money, is the worst kind of evil there is. I feel like there's a lot more character there that time constraints prevented us from experiencing, but I definitely walked away from this movie with a positive outlook on Sophia Carson. And finally, Mal, portrayed by the one and only Dove Cameron. Get into the review. Forget you saw that. Anyways, surprising absolutely no one, I think Mal's nuanced and detailed character is the best in the movie. Many consider Maleficent the most evil of all the Disney villains, and even the residents of Ouradon fear her a lot more than other classic villains. So Dove really had to bring her A-game to portray the heir to Disney's definition of evil. Similar to how Rowan Blanchard acted in Invisible Sister, or even Zac Efron back in High School Musical, Dove's performance has a lot to do with expressions and subtle nuances that inform us of Mal's internal struggle without her having to actually say it when the movie isn't in musical mode. What makes all these roles great is the fact that when there's no music, you still feel what they're going through on the inside. When she's happy, you feel it. When she's conflicted, you feel it. When she's angry, boy do you feel it. Mal is a great character because there are many different sides of her that are revealed throughout the course of the movie, and by the time the movie ends, we're still not 100% sure whether or not she's evil. If you're a Dove Cameron fan, you'll probably like her in this role, and if you're not, you probably just became one. And that's Descendants. So, what's the verdict? Descendants is a pretty good movie. Not earth-shattering or life-changing, but pretty good. I expected something more along the lines of Avengers with actual Disney characters when I first heard about this movie way back in 2014, and, obviously, it wasn't that, but it really wasn't supposed to be. For what we got, I really did enjoy it. I particularly enjoyed all the major historical parallels ingrained in this movie regarding the aforementioned racial undertones, as well as most of the lead character performances. The songs all around aren't that memorable, but some really do get the job done. It sets the bar high for itself, and I don't think it quite reached it, but ambition in DCOM should be encouraged. And yes, in case you haven't already heard, Descendants 2 is already in production, and my hope is that it outdoes the original. This is my challenge to the great Kenny Ortega. Please make Descendants 2 not good, not great, but spectacular. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this review, help me out with the likes and the subs, and don't forget to share this video all over social media. It really helps. And comment with what DCOM I should tackle next. Until then!